Our second passage follows a passage that Pastor Heather read, and we always like to take it a little bit further than what I'm going to read. But today we're going to stop short, and you can fill in the blank yourself. Luke 2. In those days, a decree went out from Emperor Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration and was taken while Quirinius was governor of Syria. All went to their own towns to be registered. Joseph also went from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to the city of David called Bethlehem, because he was descended from the house and family of David. He went to be registered with Mary, to whom he was engaged and who was expecting a child. This is God's word for God's people. You know, as I was preparing for this morning's sermon, I kept running into the same story from various sources. And so I figured if I keep running into it, it might be one that needs to be shared again if you've heard it. It's the story of a man who committed himself to seek God's presence in his life, but he didn't even know how to begin. So he put himself under the tutelage of a wise old man, and for hours under his teaching and guidance, he practiced the spiritual disciplines of prayer and study. But he failed to experience God's presence. So after several weeks of this, he confronted the old man and point blank asked him, "What can I do to experience the presence of God?" And the teacher, as a teacher is wont to do, responded to his question with a question. "What can you do to make the sun rise?" Well, it's a ridiculous question and an obvious answer. Nothing. And then the wise old man waited for the next question to kind of bubble up in the seeker's mind. And when it did, he said, "But teacher, if that's true, then why do you keep teaching us the spiritual disciplines of prayer and study?" "Ah," said the teacher, "that's so you'll be awake when the sun rises." Our task in the season of Advent is to train ourselves to wait in anticipation. That anticipation is an active expectation for the coming light so that we will be awake when the sun rises. So let's open our two passages this morning from Luke to see how this might apply to us today as we wait in this season of Advent. Would you pray with me? Lord Jesus, come. It's easy to hang lights by presence. It's not so easy to wait. Open our hearts, open our spiritual ears this Advent season, that we may hear your word for us today. And may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, Lord, for you are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Luke is very intentional about telling of the coming Savior. In chapter 1, Mary is informed of her role in the salvation coming, and she accepts that role. She goes to see her cousin Elizabeth, who is way past the age of childbearing, and yet Elizabeth, she finds, is pregnant. Her husband Zechariah was so stunned by this change of events that in his disbelief, he is unable to talk until after his son John is born and named. In the act of faith, that is, in the naming of his son John, this miracle baby, according to God's instruction, rather than naming him after himself, Zechariah is suddenly able to speak. And the first words out of his mouth are praises to God for the coming birth of God's salvation. And then in verse 77, he identifies his son John's role as the forerunner, the preparer of the way for the Messiah. And then he identifies the purpose of the Messiah. The Messiah will be salvation for God's people through the forgiveness of sins. a little piece kind of slips in on us in this long song. And then he wraps all of this up with a beautiful metaphor of this Messiah's birth. He says, the dawn from on high will break upon us to give light to those who sit in darkness and in the shadow of death, to guide our feet into the way of peace. And the sudden outburst of Zechariah, the man who can now miraculously speak, causes the tongues all throughout Judea to wag, building up anticipation in Luke's story through the high drama of miracles. It's like the gradual buildup in a TV show that takes us right to the edge of the big reveal and then breaks for a commercial. Don't you hate that? And it's always something dumb, something for back pain or something for incontinence or something that you really don't want to watch. And so in Luke, we move from the miracle in chapter 1 to the reality of our dull and boring lives in chapter 2. And Luke says, in those days, a decree went out from Emperor Augustus. Now, what do we do when the commercial comes on? Don't you get up and go to the next room, right? You go get a snack, you go play on the computer, you go do something. And our advertisers know this. You know why I know that? Because they crank the volume up on the commercials so that you can still hear it wherever you are. Do you listen anyway? No. No. We don't pay much attention because we don't expect the commercial to be of any usefulness or help, really. Such is the beauty of Luke's transition from chapter 1 into chapter 2. The whole of Judea is waiting for the big reveal. And Luke tells the story in a simple and straightforward matter-of-fact commercial. No big reveal or drama or miracle announcement, which is actually a clue to how God works in our world. Joseph and Mary are required by law to make a 3-day trek to Bethlehem. That's 3 days on the back of a donkey, 8 3/4 months pregnant, in order to register as taxpayers to the Roman government. The government really doesn't care that this is a personal hardship for them, and particularly a personal hardship for Mary. They don't care. Mary's close to the time that she will deliver her baby. But in a few simple statements, Luke has declared that while the hills are alive with the anticipated coming of the Messiah, no one's paying attention to the rather plain and ordinary event of a couple registering to pay their taxes. The timing of this decree by Augustus, who did not believe or acknowledge God's presence anyway, much less his promises, the timing of this decree with the birth of Mary's child means that even Augustus was an instrument of God's work in the world around him. And the world, even the Jewish world, was out of the room for the big reveal. They were looking west, and the sun rose in the east. He was not born among the high drama, miraculous, or the high visibility of political power. No, he was born in the commercial of the ordinary, and only a few saw it coming. And I think Luke is saying something about how God comes to us, even today. You know, we prepare for Christmas in a lot of different ways, but we have so invested ourselves in the dressings of Christmas that we miss the coming of our Savior in our ordinary, dull, and sometimes depressing everyday lives. When my oldest son was about 2, I had him in the child seat of a grocery cart. Have you ever gone shopping with a 2-year-old in the car seat of a grocery cart? And I had stopped at the meat display to pick out the meat for the week's meals. And while I was focusing on which cut to purchase, how much hamburger do I need, Aaron leaned over the side of the cart and was merrily poking holes in all the plastic wrap of the meat. Now, I was under the pressure of trying to shop on a schedule with a 2-year-old, and these childish antics tipped me past my patience point. Now, I don't remember what I said to him or how I said it to him, but I remember an elderly man who was watching all of this and taking it all in. And he approached my shopping cart and he looked at me and he said this, "You know, Mom, it's really hard to be 2 years old." And I recognized in that moment that I might have had a God moment. I might have. Friends, it may surprise you to know how many times God shows up in the aisle of the grocery store, in the ordinary places that we go. And that day, the gift I received was an attitude check. And my son received the gift of his mother back. Advent is a time of expectant preparation to receive the coming Savior. Expectant. Ask any pregnant women, they can tell you what expectant means. That's an active waiting. It's a waiting framed with promise that he will come. And how he comes oftentimes surprises us. Such expectancy appears and opens up our arms to receive the precious gift of God as promised. Even if we can't see how or when salvation comes. But when we wait expectantly, when we wait with our arms open wide to receive him when he appears in the ordinary places of our lives much more than we really know. Such active waiting changes how we respond to the world around us. For when we wait with arms open wide, we may actually see the face of Jesus in the known and the unknown people whom we encounter. Lord, as the melodrama of the Christmas season unfolds around us, may we be found facing east and wake when you rise into our lives. Help us open ourselves to your promises, especially as we slog through whatever life circumstances threaten to hide your light. For it's in your name.